has been making a lot of progress in a lot of, you know, new capabilities being added on day-to-day basis in there. So the agenda of this session is primarily go through what Azure Search is, why we need it, and you know, why should you use this as a platform as a service provided by Azure in your application as an alternative to whatever search capabilities which you might be having in your application. So we'll look at all the aspects right from the start. So even if you are new to full text search or anything, that's fine. We'll cover the basics and then we'll deep dive into the Azure Search as well as the cognitive aspect of it. All right. So first of all, I'd like to thank Synergetics Learning to give me this platform and, you know, interacting with you all to be able to, you know, kind of have an interactive conversation on this particular feature, Azure Search, and sharing my thoughts on, you know, what Azure have been providing us and how we are using it so that we can spread it around and probably harness the benefits out of it. So okay, I think I'm audible now. Someone muted me. All right, so I'm audible now. All right, great. Thanks, sir. All right, so one of the most popular reasons why I see Azure becoming so popular is because of the cognitive services or the Azure AI engine, which has been infused into Azure Search lately, which was basically a full text search engine, but with the cognitive capabilities attached to it out of the box, it has becoming more and more popular so that, you know, you get all the various insights as well as, you know, meaningful data extracted out of your huge data repository out of the box. So you don't have to worry about indexes, partitioning, replicas, and all of those stuff. So all of those stuff has been abstracted away from you. And, you know, so that is the reason why Azure Search has been becoming so popular. Right. So, so before we move on, if you have any questions, you know, let's just, you know, you can enter it in the chat and we can go through it for the at the end of the presentation, so that we cover most of the topics, and then we can have the Q&A session at the last 30 minutes if that works with you all. All right. Right. So. And also, you know, feel free to contribute or mention if anything I have missed, because you might be working on something which, you know, is something which is very different and or a very different use case which might be helpful to all. So feel free to share that that as well. So you can see my presentation, I think, and so I'm just confirming which screen are you looking at. So I think it's the first slide. Now I'm moving to the second slide, where I'll introduce myself. So my name is Deepak Agarwal. I belong to iCertis Solutions Private Limited, based out of Pune, and we are kind of with a mission of building the contract management platform, leveraging Microsoft Azure. So basically we do all kinds of contracting stuff. So we are building a platform at various levels, right from buy side, sell side contracts to all of the enterprise contracts and all the workflows and everything. So we are into that kind of a domain, and the de facto leader currently for the contract management, for digitizing your contracts. So, and iCert is, as a company, you can say it's kind of born in cloud in 2009 in Azure. So we have been working with Azure closely with the Microsoft team as well from the past 10 years. And, you know, we are using most of the kinds of the services in order to, you know, scale our platform better, use our platform better and a more intelligent way. So that's all about me. So I'm basically working into Microsoft technology stack from the past 10 years, and I've worked on cloud Microsoft Azure as part of iCertis a lot. So moving on, so I'll just quickly spend two to five minutes on what iCertis, you know, kind of has its footprint all over the globe. So we have around 12 offices worldwide and a couple of more coming up soon. And so we have two development centers, one in Pune, three support centers, and we manage around 5.7 million contracts, which is kind of a huge number to look at. And we have been consistently rated as a top company to work for in the Washington state. So we won many awards there as well. So most of the customers we have of various domains. So we have from automotive, transportation, you know, Daimler, Microsoft, including the huge names, Cognizant, the IT sector, retail. So, you know, we work with most of the customers, and the numbers are pretty interesting. So 5.7 million contracts, 40 plus languages in 90 plus countries. So it's a huge number, which kind of we are dealing with, and we are working at very high scale using the contract management platform, right? So the mission, vision, and values of iCertis. So I'll quickly go through that. So the mission is, as I said, so be the contract management platform of the world to seamlessly kind of have an experience from the of the contracts which are being involved. And if this is the first time where the contract has been digitized, so, you know, with the AI capabilities and everything infused into it, it's becoming more smarter and easy to adopt. So that is kind of our mission aligns with. The vision is, you know, transform the foundation of commerce, and the values is something which we strongly believe in all of our employees, right from CEO to interns. So we believe strongly in our values called Forte, which is fairness, openness, respect, teamwork, and execution. So we strongly live by it every day, and kind of, you know, ensure that everyone is aligned with those particular values as we move along in becoming the leader. All right, so let's get started to the topic. So Azure Search, so does anyone have any, you know, knowledge about full text search engine? Probably you can mention it in our chats. Why do we need Azure Search, or are we already using Azure Search or any full text search engine? So if anyone have used full text search like Elasticsearch, Solr, there are many platforms out there from the beginning, and we'll see why we need Azure Search. Anyone using full text search in your applications? All right, so I don't think so. So, you know, it's kind of a Google search, right? So we use Google search right from our childhood days, and basically it's all kinds of search we do on day-to-day basis based on the keyword search and everything, right? So behind the scenes, it uses a very popular library called an Apache Lucene project. So not the Google search, but all the other search platforms which has been available on the web called, you know, Solr was the first one. It's probably the oldest platform which has been available for full text search, and it's completely open source Apache Lucene project, and the oldest search engine which has been available in the market. So it's primarily based on full text search, the semantic search capabilities, but Elasticsearch is really, you know, kind of a search technology on top of Solr. It both uses Apache Lucene behind the scenes, but Elasticsearch has moved forward one step ahead, which providing the Elasticsearch, I mean the full text search primarily, plus you can have visualization capabilities, and you know, you can have analytics, log analytics, all kinds of stuff with Elasticsearch. So the ELK stack you might have come across with as a term called Elasticsearch, Logstash, Kibana. So Kibana is a visualizing tool which Elasticsearch is kind of, you know, seamlessly integrate with to provide the log analytics as well as the visualization tool for your search queries. Now there's also a Bing web search APIs which you can call. So Microsoft have provided APIs to interact with the Bing search, and using your search queries you can also get the results out of Bing search, and you also have a full text search in SQL as well. So why do you really need Elasticsearch? We'll get to you know, in a few minutes. So these are the search technologies I just wanted to put forward, so that, you know, at an enterprise level, these are the search engines which we deal with mostly. But why Azure Search shines among this, we'll look at it in the next slide. Okay. So you can see the Azure Search, just a quick check on the slides. So the why and what slide of Azure Search you can see right now, correct? Can you just ping on the chat, maybe yes or no, if you can see my screen, the PowerPoint slide. Okay, great. So Azure Search, as I mentioned, is one of the services provided by Azure. It's fully PaaS kind of a search, where your Elasticsearch and everything has been managed by Azure itself. Right, so you can say that it's an Elasticsearch which is fully managed at cloud scale. You don't have to, you know, go into the nitty-gritties of setting it up, partition, shards, nodes, etc., and all of it has been provided as a service. So, you know, everything right from setting it up to infusing the AI capabilities has been done through the portal, and it's been all handled by Azure itself as an infrastructure at cloud scale. So you get the full text search analytics, full text search as well as the text analysis out of the box. You have the cognitive search. So Azure Search basically provides the full text search engine, plus out of the box you can also integrate seamlessly with the cognitive APIs, which is available on Azure as services. You have vision, text, speech, language, etc. Lots of Azure AI capabilities which has been coming up. So you can seamlessly integrate with those, with your data present in your search indexes, and which basically becomes your cognitive search. And you know, you can leverage it in your applications for more smarter search capabilities. So we'll look at that, how it gets used. So there will be hands-on and everything later as we move forward. So other thing is, you know, we had this SQL search, SQL server, full text search, but it only works with the SQL server. Now with Azure Search, you have a flexibility of integrating with any kinds of data source. Maybe it's a PDF, a PNG file, a document, you know, so there are n number of formats which has been supported, which makes it really powerful, because you know, with structured and unstructured data at hand, you can, you know, kind of extract meaningful insights out of it, you know, just by a click of a button, right? So that too at cloud scale. So that's really very powerful what Azure Search provides you in terms of data and data source flexibility. So GeoSearch is also one of the capabilities which Azure Search internally uses. So let's say you want to search quickly, you know, best five restaurants around me. So it has that a data type called EDM, so entity data model geography point. So it has all kinds of data types to support all kinds of fields, numbers, strings, etc. And it also supports the geography point in order to search proximities, kind of a search where you can search anything near to your location or a particular location. So it supports that as well out of the box. Now recently, Azure Search have come up, it's very recent actually, an integration called Knowledge Store, which is in preview mode. You can experiment it in Azure portal. So it runs parallelly with Azure Search. Actually, it's kind of a store where all the enrichments. So enrichments is nothing but the documents which are being passed through the AI pipeline gets enriched. We'll see, how does that happen? But the enriched documents can be stored, and whatever cognitive capabilities have been applied on those documents are stored in Azure, let's say blob storage, SQL, or whatever storage of your choice, so that it can be consumed by other visualization tools very easily, called maybe Power BI or any other custom visualization tool you may have. So this is kind of a capability which has been provided by Azure very recently, a knowledge store, although it doesn't, you know, kind of integrates or has connection with Azure Search, but the output of Azure Search is something which can be stored and can be consumed. So it runs parallelly with that. As I said, Azure Search supports all kinds of formats, the documents, whatever documents you give, maybe it's a PDF, a scanned PDF, right? So a Microsoft, all the Microsoft Office files, HTML, JSON, zip files, CSV, JPEG. So all structured and unstructured data, whatever you think of, you can put it in one single blob container, and Azure Search will dig in and, you know, behind the scenes, extract all kinds of meaningful data and insights from those particular documents, as extract the data and present it to you in a more smarter way, and you can query that. So it has the data sources. As I said, it can connect to Azure SQL. It can connect to SQL Server infrastructure as a service. You know, in an Azure VM, maybe you have an SQL Server deployed, or you can connect it to Cosmos DB, the NoSQL capability provided by Azure. Blob storage, MySQL, Azure Files, which is currently in private preview, right? So you can connect to any type of data sources, and it has all the flexibility attached to it. So the cognitive part of it, so I'll just quickly go through, you know, kind of the basics, and then we can deep dive into the actual hands-on kind of stuff. Is anyone speaking anything? Okay. All right, so those were the Azure Search part of it. On top of it, you know, as I mentioned, the cognitive APIs which Azure has, you know, the key phrases, extracting the key phrases, or the language detection, the sentiment analysis, all kinds of Azure AI capabilities, you can say, which we call it as a cognitive services which Azure has, or the Microsoft Azure provides, is seamlessly integrated into Azure Search itself, so that whenever you know the data gets indexed into Azure Search, it gets indexed with all the skills being run on top of it, and then you can search it smartly based on whatever skill sets you have been infused into your indexes. So as you can see, all the predefined cognitive skills, key phrases, language detection, text splitter, plus you can also add your own custom skills. So we'll also see how you can add your own custom skills. Maybe some of the predefined skills may not suit your purpose. You have your own Azure function working or running somewhere, or Azure APIs running somewhere, which you need to invoke in the pipeline during your index creation or during enhancement of your indexes. You can do that as well. Any REST APIs you can add. So we'll see it once we do some hands-on activity. All right, so enough of slides. So let's get it right into the portal and do some basic search index capabilities. Okay, so let me open my browser. Okay, let me share my screen first so that you can see the browser. So let's create a basic index, right? How to create a basic Azure search index, and we'll take things from there. Can you see the Azure portal on my screen? Just quickly checking.
Yes.
All right, great, thanks. So create a new source, Azure search. So you can give it a name, let's say Wednesday webinar search. So looks like it has some so it doesn't consider the dashes and the dots. That's fine. Subscription is okay. Resource group, maybe I'll create a new one. Let's say live demo webinar. Right, location West US is fine. Pricing tier, so you have several pricing tiers to look at, free, basic, standards. We'll get into that a bit later, but as you can see, it also has a free tier which of course some limitations to it, but for now standard works fine. So I'll just select it by default, which has been provided, and we'll create this particular search service. So it takes maybe max a minute or so. To create a search service, right, so the deployment is in progress. So in the meantime, let me see if I have any questions on chat. Okay, so we are planning to use Elasticsearch for log storage and report retrieval. Right, Kibana and Elasticsearch, that's good. So maybe, you know, Shachindra, right? So you are exploring Elasticsearch, Kibana, Elasticsearch. Now, once we are through with all the capabilities what Azure Search has, you can leverage this or give it a thought, you know, kind of using it at planet scale. So it's something which you can explore. once you know the capabilities of Azure Search. So it's basically Elasticsearch running behind the scenes, just, you know, all the infrastructure capabilities has been abstracted away from you. All right, so our search is ready, search service. So we'll quickly move through all the components. So it has an index. You can import data. I'll come to that a bit later. Search Explorer is nothing but, you know, an inbuilt tool which has been provided inside the portal, where you can query anything, right? So it's basically OData queries which you can have. Either you can use Search Explorer here, or I prefer Postman actually for any kind of REST API. So we'll do that. Right. So I'll come to that a bit later. So you have keys for authentication or communication with this particular service. You can scale this up and down. Now scaling is scaling can be replicas or adding partitions. So replicas are nothing but, you know, if you have an application where you are getting a lot of search requests, and your application and one search service may not fit the bill for you, right? So you kind of distribute your workloads across different services. So you can add as many replicas as you want, right? So 3-4 replicas, so that the load gets distributed automatically. And this is all, so remember, this is a PaaS service, so we don't have to really worry about load balancers and those kind of stuff. So it automatically chooses whatever instances or the services as per your region. And the next thing is the partition. So you can also have, so you have a large data, let's say, and indexing that particular data, or having only one index for those particular large documents or data is really not kind of recommended. So you can have partitions or segregations of your particular index of your data, so that, you know, it becomes manageable as well as spans across multiple indexes or partitions, so that you get really fast performance in terms of your search queries. Now your pricing, the pricing tier which we discussed before, the tax is basically, you will see something called as search units. Now the search units is basically nothing but your multiplication of replicas as well as the partition. So we'll keep one and one for the demo right now. Of the 36 available search units, so we have one search unit, but 36 are available based on the pricing tier I selected. I selected standard, so it has a maximum of 36 search units. Also remember, Azure provides 99% availability only if you have two replicas or more than two replicas. So if you have only one replica and one partition, you may not get that particular 99.9% SLA basically. So you have certain analytics on top of it, right? So, and identity as well. So we'll not go much into details here at the moment, but, you know, let's quickly build an index first, right? So either you can add an index manually, but Azure supports a push and a pull model. So we'll see what it is in a moment, but let me click on import data. So in the data source, as I mentioned previously, there are many different data sources which Azure Search supports. You can have some of the samples. So it's kind of, you know, just a quick start or for demo purposes like this. We have some samples ready. So this is an SQL data store database basically, or you can have a NoSQL kind of a sample, but you can connect to Azure SQL databases, on-prem VMs, block storage, table storage. Now, one important point to note here is the Azure portal kind of has limited capabilities you know, in terms of configuration of your indexes as well as the search queries, etc. But with the REST APIs and using the CLI command tools, you have more options available, which is not surfaced visually through portal, but it has more capabilities. So, and the data sources which you see here is just a small, maybe a subset of the other data sources which you might have in your application, which you can connect it using REST APIs. So REST APIs have something which is more powerful and which has all the capabilities. But to start with, we can use the portal for simplicity. I'll select a database, right? So let's have a SQL database attached to my search. We'll explore the cognitive search later on, right? So we'll just get the feel of a full text search kind of capability first, and then add cognitive search on top of it, right? So as you can see, you can name your index whatever name you want to give, and every index should have a unique ID. So the real estate US sample, which is a structured database kind of a scenario, relational database, has a listing ID column, which has picked itself as a key, right? And suggester is something which is, you know, as you type in, you get autofill or suggest kind of an experience. So let's say if I type like this, webinar, something. So this is the suggesters field. What fields do you want, field values do you want to be available in this kind of a search, right? So those are the suggester. You can give any name you want. And the search mode currently is only one, which is analyzing infix matching. This is nothing but a substring search, which you type in, right? And as you can see, the fields which are present here is, you know, Azure Search have detected your data source, and automatically it has inferred all the fields which is possible in this particular index. So this is really powerful. You don't have to add or create fields manually. You can either, you know, delete or add a field, but out of the box, Azure is smart enough to see the data as well as, you know, present you the fields which it's feels like should be part of that index. So I'm getting some background noise. Any questions there? So you can see, so these are probably the columns of the database, right, which we have selected. And by default, Azure have marked it as, you know, some of the columns as retrievable. So retrievable is nothing but after search, which fields do you want to retrieve, field values. Filterable is nothing but which fields do you want to, you know, allow filtering on. Sortable, facetable is nothing but your aggregation kind of queries, where you say, give me a count where, you know, the total, give me a count of the city where the total number of beds is, you know, kind of, let's say, greater than 50 or some kind of thing. So it's kind of an aggregation scenario. So we'll look at that example as well as we move along. And searchable is by default, you know, most of the fields are searchable. IDs generally, people do not search. It's mostly the text fields, which text field and collections, which people search on. So we have a collection field as also, as I mentioned previously, there are different data types, right? So there's string, integer, as well as the geography, the location, and the collection. So this is basically the tags associated for that particular real estate. So remember, we are using a real estate kind of a scenario here. So there are different analyzers. Now, analyzers are nothing but actually we'll take a deep look into it, but just a quick minute there. So analyzer is nothing but you have how do you want to index this particular data. So basically you can have filters and tokenizations assigned or applied to your particular field, and then you can choose different analyzers so that particular field goes through that analysis phase and gets indexed. So out of the box, so we'll take a look in deeper into it, but just out of the box, Azure provides you around 56 analyzers, different analyzers to choose from. And by default, it has chosen English, Microsoft, since this is a German description, it has chosen the German analyzer. So it's nothing but how you want to treat your particular data to be indexed and how do you want it to be indexed into your Azure search. So we'll get to that a bit later. So that is the analyzer. You can customize it. You can choose whichever one you want. You can also provide your custom analyzer. Now remember, if previously I had mentioned that portal has certain limitations, but using REST APIs, you can add your own custom analyzer and attach your own custom analyzer to a particular field in Azure Search Index. Right. So suggesters are nothing but, as I mentioned, as you go and type, the suggestions has been provided. Now, which fields do you want in the suggestions to be applicable? You can select it from here. So I'll keep most of these as by default, right? And I'll say create an indexer. Now, this is something where we have created our particular index, right? And now I'm creating an indexer. Now, indexer is nothing but you can say a web job or a job which runs maybe once, or you can customize it as per your need so that the index get enriched or populated from the data sources as and when needed, right? So you can trigger it on demand or you can schedule it based on whatever needs you have, right? So I'll just call it as my indexer, right? Or a schedule can be configured. Now, since this is a sample, I've chosen a sample database, it's not allowing me to select the other type of schedules, but as you can see, you can choose hourly, daily, or custom kind of a schedule to run and populate your index incrementally as and when the data gets updated. Some of the advanced options, so base64 encoded keys. So now, as I mentioned earlier, an index needs to have a particular key which is unique across. Now, you cannot have any special characters, spaces, etc. into your keys. Now, this, if you check this base64 encoded keys, it will base64 encode your particular data or the key value and then add to the index. So this is more suitable where you add cognitive searches or your data source is something unstructured, which is a blob or a text file or something like that. But for this particular scenario, we don't need base64 encoding. The other items are basically, let you specify a count where even if let's say you have thousands of records and during indexing 10 of them fail to get indexed, so do you want to like kind of stop the indexing altogether, or do you want to return an error message or something like that, or what is your tolerance level for that particular scenario? So you can have a maximum failed items. Okay, so if I say 50 here, so I am okay if 50 of them is not indexed or those kind of scenario. Also, max failed items per batch, you can, you know, have indexing applicable, or the indexer can run on batches. So once the data goes to a 50 number or 100 number, then only run this particular indexer. So that kind of batching is also possible. So I leave those as by default for now, and I click on submit. So this will create my index, run my indexer, and my index should be ready to search in just a moment. So if you have any questions in the meantime, let me know on chat, or maybe you can speak out. I see one person waiting in the lobby, so Manish, if you don't mind, you can add Aishali. So I can click refresh and the indexes get updated. My indexer is running. Okay, so indexer is successful and it ran, and the number of documents are 4959. Right? Just give me a minute. All right, so we have our data source here. Skill sets is something which we'll look at once we do the cognitive search. So we have our basic index ready, whatever we selected as a sample, and what you'll have it in Elasticsearch. And let's play around this a bit. I have some queries which has been, kind of ready to go. So let's see. So I have a basic query. Let's see. You can use a search explorer, or I'll bring up Postman real quick. Just give me a sec. Can you see my Postman screen? All right, so let's get started with some basic queries. So this is the URL for your query to search, right? And you have to provide an API version to it, right? So remember, this is evolving. So in order to maintain the backward compatibility, we'll have to provide the API version you are dealing with. So I have certain queries ready with me of a different index. We can use that. Or maybe I'll just make a copy of it. So this is the same real estate US sample. Now what we are doing is, so this is my search search service which we created and indexes. This is my index and I want to retrieve all the documents which has been indexed, API version, and I want to search on a city called Seattle on all the documents which has been indexed, right? So I'll just give it a send. Now remember, you have to provide the value, the API key in the header for authentication. So let me just fetch it from the portal here real quick. There you go. And you have all your search results, you know, in within a second, actually, around 1 second. So you have a search score associated with your every search result. So this is basically nothing but your scoring index, how best your result matches to your particular search. We have entered search as Seattle, so this is around 0.16 match, the listing ID and all the columns which has been marked as searchable or filterable during index creation is present in the output, right? So we have around, you know, a lot of documents actually which matches the word Seattle in either the description field or the tag field or days on the market. You can also select which fields your search queries should run on using the searchable flag. This is a basic kind of a search. Let's move ahead to some different kind of search. So let's say you want all the search. Search Seattle. And you want to know all the documents. Now this doesn't give me how many documents have been matched or the total count. So this is an OData query syntax you can use in order to search for a particular result. So you can say dollar count true. I want to see the count and the top 100 results basically, right? Again, I need to use the same authentication. Right, and you can see that we have around 1800 documents which matched our query, and you know, similar scoring and all the fields basically on top of it. So facet queries is something which is interesting. So as I mentioned, facets are nothing but, you know, you can have aggregation kind of a queries which can be applied. Now let me run that real quick and I'll explain as we move. So facet means you search for all the documents, not only Seattle, search everything, group by city and give only the first top two results out of this search. So let me hit a send. So in Seattle, I have around 1800, you know, real estate, maybe flats or bungalows kind of assets. And in Kent City, I have 520. In Bellevue, I have 422. So facet is nothing but aggregation on top of whatever field you provide, and it will give you the count. It's basically a group by sort of a query if you're familiar with SQL. Highlights is nothing but, you know, so when you search for a particular field, so many times, you know, you want to highlight that particular search in our results like Google does, right? So if you say search for granite countertop, so all the assets where which has the granite countertops, and highlight the description basically. So in the description field, so you need to provide the field in which you want to highlight this particular search, So in description, I see this particular text, and the search field, whatever I've entered, has been emphasized with a EM HTML tag. So these are nothing but, you know, I'm going through some basic search stuff. Of course, you can use, you know, a lot of search capabilities which is provided by Elasticsearch. This is just a tip of the iceberg just to get going. Now, fuzzy search is something which is also very popular in Elasticsearch or a full text search kind of a scenario, where you have a spelling mistake, but still it gives you a result, right? So if you say, let me copy the token as well. Right, so and I click on send. So it says search on a city called Sammamish. Now note that the spelling is kind of there's a spelling mistake here, so it should be double M. Nevertheless, it has got me the results for Sammamish. Right, so if I say right, so it's Sammamish. I've missed an M, but with the tilde sign, you instruct your Azure search to do a fuzzy search and a query type. Now, this is an interesting parameter. You have two modes of query types, basically simple or default. So by default, it is simple, which I haven't used in my previous queries. But with fuzzy search, it's full. Full means, you know, it uses your, you can use your regular expressions while querying. You can use your wildcard in queries and all sorts of stuff with query type full. So it's all the capabilities which Elasticsearch provides, you can use with query type full. And basic is nothing but your logical AND or operations you can do while searching. Right, location is nothing but, so I'll not execute it, but you get the idea, right? So location is nothing but give me all the results, you know, basically the count of the results, and filter based on the nearest location provided, which is the geo.distance, and you can use your inbuilt queries to in order to fetch that particular data for that near that particular location. So you can have filter queries on that. So any questions so far before I move ahead? On chat, maybe you can unmute yourself or something like that. So I'll wait for a minute if any questions, and then I can move. All right, so feel free to type in. Yeah, please go ahead. Questions, anyone? All right, maybe we can take it after later. So Rina, you can type in your question. Maybe, you know, we can take it a bit later. Right, so that was just a basic gist of a search just to start with. Now we'll get into some details of it. Now there's an interesting GitHub project. I'll just share my other window, which is called as Azure Search Generator. So it's pretty handy kind of a tool which has been generated for us by Microsoft. Let me share my screen. So you can just type in Azure Search Generator in Google and you'll see this particular page. In order to quickly generate a sample search application, Azure have provided this particular, or Microsoft and the community, GitHub community has provided this excellent tool where you just type in your query key. Query key is nothing but your authentication key, right? So I'll just add my query key and Azure Search Index JSON. Now this is nothing but your index structure which you have. You can get your index structure using Postman. Let me duplicate my display so that it will be. So your index schema, you can get it via Postman. So let me paste it in here. So it should be webinar search. And the key should be this. Right, so you can query your index schema with indexes slash the index name and the API version. Copy the entire thing in the result, paste it in this text box. And what is your service name? So it's HTTP web. .search.windows.net and I say generate app. Now immediately it gives me an HTML, nice formatted HTML where I can execute or use. All right, so yeah, one more point. So it's giving me errors. So let's look at that. So it's a course error. So as you know, this is a cross domain kind of an error which we need to kind of enable because it's trying to call a different domain from my application. So I'll just quickly enable the cross domain here. So you have a course option on the Azure portal. Just say allow all origins for now and I say save. Yeah, so there are problems with Azure portal saving, so I'll just enable it via REST APIs. So you need to provide the entire index schema which we got earlier, right? And the authentication token in the body part. You have the entire schema and the course option takes in I believe it's allow, but let's quickly check that. Allowed origins, right? So I want to allow all for now.
Okay, so 204 successful. It should show me course has been enabled here. Right. Close this. Right, so it is enabled. So the reason I did this purposefully is because, you know, as you can see, the portal doesn't have much of, you know, it has a limited capability as well as some issues with it. So REST API works just fine with all capabilities. So, and if I search here, let's say Seattle, it should start working. Right, so now you can see a nice user interface which has all the fields and values which you were searching using Postman. So this is just I wanted to give you kind of an idea where you can quickly generate a sample application and you can work around on the UI stuff a bit better. But this is out of the box, which is which Microsoft have provided. Right, so moving on to the next, you know, let's go back to the presentation and continue from there. Share the presentation. So you should be seeing my presentation where I have pulled up the index slide. So we have gone through this, right? So the index schema, so index is like nothing but a database table which holds your data. In Elasticsearch or in the full text search terms, it is called as a document. And the index schema looks like this with all the properties, right? So this is when you create using REST API. So all the fields, searchable, filterable, whatever we saw on the UI, right? So I'll quickly go to the next one. So it has analyzers, synonym maps. We'll discuss about this as we move ahead. Azure Search analyzers. Now, what are analyzers? So analyzers are nothing but, as I mentioned, it's basically adds or manipulates your data in such a way that it becomes easily searchable when you search for a particular content or a keyword, right? So it comprises of your filters and tokenizers. Now consider an input as shown on the screen where you have a paragraph and it has some text in it, right? So the quick brown fox jumps over the lazy dog. So this is an input to an analyzer. Now what analyzer does is it has a lot of filters and it has a lot of tokenizers. Now these filters and tokenizers, some are provided out of the box, some you can add your own custom and hook it up via REST APIs, right? So first filter is maybe a care filter where it strips off HTML stripper, as it mentioned. So it strips off all the HTML tags because that is not really the intent or of search. Basically, the search will only happen on the text which is inside, right? So it strips off all the unnecessary kind of text around a particular around that particular text. Basically, tokenizers is nothing but it divides or splits your entire text into small tokens so that it get indexed, and during your full text search this comes into play where you search for a particular word called fox or maybe jumps, and this particular document which has this text is comes out in the result. So there are many tokenizers. Now tokenizer behave differently based on the tokenizer you choose. So this is a standard tokenizer. You can have Lucene tokenizer. You can have different tokenizers, right? So this particular standard tokenizers have just split the word, split the text into different words, right? Now these tokenized words or these particular individual words pass through a series of filters again. So number of filters, number of tokenizers is basically which you choose before indexing that particular document. Now this particular token, after the output of the tokenizer is passed to the token filter, where the stop words, right? The stop words are nothing but words which are of normally comes in every sentences, or you know, it's kind of like and the kind of words which rarely user searches on. So it removes those particular stop words because those are the words which are very common, and it's not really of that important in a search. So the stop words filter removes those particular words. So as you can see, the is removed, you know, in the output. Now that output is passed again to the lowercase kind of a filter. Now this is optional filters you can build on top of it. So it lowercases all your terms and then index it. So the reason behind this is you can have your searching in a case insensitive kind of a manner, and lower casing is one of the filter which we can use. So this is how analyzer works with a series of tokenizers and filters in order before your entire document gets indexed, right? Can as I mentioned earlier, you can also build your own custom analyzers and include them in your index definitions. But out of the box, Microsoft provides you 56 such analyzers, as you have seen before in the Azure portal, which you can choose from. Now to check the index terms, so there is an API called Analyze API. So we'll just check that real quick. How your text gets analyzed. So let me again go back to Postman and let me share my screen again. You must be seeing Postman now coming up. All right, so this is nothing but a different search service, a similar search service which you had created earlier, indexes the same index, right? And there is an analyze kind of an action which we can use in the REST API. So you can just have a post query. You add the text or whatever text you want to analyze to see how different analyzers work, right? So you have the text and the analyzer, which is, I'll apply the standard analyzer which we saw on the screen, and in the output we see how the tokens are generated or will be indexed in our particular Azure search. So this is the token, the text. So remember, the text was text to analyze, so it has lowercased it, text to analyze, and it also mentions the start and end offset and the position where the word occurs in the particular text. So in place of, let's say, analyzer, I say Lucene. Lucene, maybe it's so there are different analyzers. Let me see. Right, so stop is another kind of an analyzer where it removes the stop words. Now you can see from the output, it has removed the two because it is kind of not that important during search, and it has maintained the other words in the output to be indexed. So two is a stop word which has been removed using the stop analyzer. So in this way, you can use different analyzers and then Azure index, your index will be enriched based on those, that particular thing. Now there's an interesting website which compares three different analyzers from Microsoft. Let me just show you that particular window.
Going back to my browser here. So it is alice.unearth.ai. So it says Azure Search Analyzer demo, and if I say interesting as, you know, kind of as a word to search, so you can see the differences between the analyzers. Now, a standard Lucene analyzer, English Lucene and English Microsoft, standard Lucene analyzers got 5 hits, but the rest got 6 hits. Now let's examine why. Now this interesting as a word is also, so as you can, as I have mentioned previously, there are for all the analyzers, there are certain, you know, tokenizations which has been happening, as well as the filters which has been happening. Now during tokenization, some of the analyzers, smart analyzers, what they do is it also retrieves or indexes the root form of a particular word or the search text. Now in this case, interesting is a word which I searched. The root form of the word of interesting is interest. So if even if I type interest, it should give up the result. So as you can see, standard Lucene didn't care about that root form word, but the rest two did care, and it gave me that particular document in the output, because English Lucene and English Microsoft is much smarter than standard Lucene to tokenize that particular word, you know, in the document to its root form as well, so that it comes up in the search results. So this is nothing but a simple capabilities, you can say, in order to understand how three different, these are only three, but you have 56 analyzers you can choose from, and they differ, you know, based on their capabilities in how smart they are. So mostly I'd recommend go for English Microsoft or Microsoft and Lucene kind of analyzers for the fields, and it should take care of all of the scenarios. Right. All right, so moving on, I'll just bring up my presentation once again. Now under the hood, the documents which has been provided to index, you know, so how it works is, I'll just quickly go through it, because it's really Elasticsearch behind the scenes at the end of the day, which uses the inverted index kind of a table to index your particular document. So these are the documents, three documents which you have, and you remove all the stop words from it, the unimportant words which is not used for indexed. And then you can it maintains a table which has the term and the document number in which it belongs to. So behind the scenes, it is stored in this particular format, which is called as inverted index. And this is much faster in, you know, during search, when it is scaled onto different servers and, you know, and also partition to different servers, so that it can be split and we get the results and collate them and get the results very soon. Now rebuilding indexes. Now once, so this, these are all the whatever I have shown the capabilities here. We created the index, we, you know, kind of queried it and seen some kind of understanding like what happens behind the scenes when we index a particular document. But let's say in a production scenario, you have built an index and you have deployed your application and everything, your search is working fine. Now
you want to, let's say 6 months down the line, you want to introduce a new field or you want to change something in your index. So do you want to delete the, will you be deleting the entire index and rebuilding it from scratch, or what are the scenarios or conditions where rebuilding is necessary and where it is not necessary? Basically, it will be incremental. Now, the index will get rebuilt, or you have to rebuild an index if you want, if the field which has already been indexed, if you rename that particular field or you change the data type of a particular field, then you have to rebuild your index. Also, attributes come into play, like searchable, filterable, sortable. If you change some kind of these attributes on that particular field, you will have to rebuild the entire index completely. If you change the analyzer, how that particular field, you know, you have standard analyzer associated with a particular field called description, and down the line you change it to something else, then you have to rebuild that particular index, right? Or you, if you remove a particular field, or if you switch the pricing tier. So, you know, there are several, like, free, basic, standard kind of a pricing tier with your Azure Search service. If you change any of that, you have to rebuild that particular index. Now, these concepts are important in production scenarios to understand, you know, there will be a downtime kind of thing when you do this particular activity. So, right from the start, if you are aware that, you know, you will design in such a way that rebuilding is not that frequent, so that user gets a consistent experience. Now, there are scenarios where you don't want to you don't need to rebuild index. So let's say you add a particular field, right? Or you set a field as retrievable kind of a property, or you change the cost settings, which we did earlier. So those kind of scenarios, you don't need to rebuild. It will be, going forward, the documents will be indexed in that in those particular new fields, and those fields will be available for searching. Now, as I said, again, the portal doesn't give you a flexibility where you rebuild the index. You can use REST API calls. So from the search documentation on Azure, you have all the REST APIs for index in order to get the index schema, rebuild an index, delete an index, etc. You have to go through REST APIs, or you can use the .NET SDK also. The second part is the concurrency. Now, similar to Elasticsearch, so when two or more requests come in order to update an index schema, so it applies the optimistic concurrency behind the scenes, where you have an E tag associated for each particular index schema, so that, you know, the concurrency is kind of taken care of. So let me just quickly show you. So earlier we had this kind of a request where, we got the schema of a particular index. So when I get the schema, it says odata.etag. So every index has an etag associated with it, right? And hence, if two or more requests come in at the same time, based on the optimistic concurrency model, and if it has the etag, the latest version is been used, and you know, the concurrency is handled in that particular manner. All right, so the next point is so Azure Search involves a push and a pull kind of a model. Now, let's say you have created an Azure Search service, which, Azure Search service, and you want to populate that Azure Search with some documents. Now there are two kinds of models which Azure supports. One is the push and one is the pull. Now push is something which you can use using REST APIs or the .NET SDKs provided. So let's say you want to populate with JSON format documents, you can post a request to the index in order to build that particular index with your data. So that is a push mechanism where you explicitly call the APIs, the REST APIs, in order to build the index. In the pull model, you just upload your documents in different data sources, maybe Cosmos DB, Blob, SQL, any kind of storage, right? And the Azure search, so we'll get to that when we do cognitive search capabilities. Azure search automatically crawls those particular data sources, infers the schema based on the particular data, what has been crawled upon, and then builds your indexes, your other properties smartly on top of it. So as we have seen earlier, I have chosen the samples databases, and I didn't need to create the schema manually or define the fields manually. It automatically created all the fields, and it automatically provided me with the default options of searchable, filterable, etc. So those kind of model is the pull model, where Azure crawls, or the indexer for that particular service crawls the data sources associated to that search service, and you get the index schema built on top of it. Of course, once you get it, you can manipulate it as per your needs. So this is a simple search request. So I'll quickly go through it now, how it, you know, happens behind the scenes. Again, this is Elasticsearch terminologies and mechanism which happens. So let's say your search consists of this particular body, where you say spacious, air condition. You can use any type of capabilities, called maybe a regular expression, wildcards, kind of a query, right? So as you can see here, you search on hotels index, right? Search, you provide the search API version, and in the body of the search request, you say, bring me all the documents or all the data which contains spacious, air conditioned is a prefix query, right? And which must contain an ocean view. So this plus denotes a mandatory kind of a requirement, with ocean view as the complete term and not ocean and view as separate terms occurring in the document. You can also specify the search fields, on which particular fields do you want this search to execute upon, the search mode. So this is any. You also have a different kind of a search mode, which we'll get to in a bit. Filter, you can apply filters, you can order the results, and the query type. So query type we covered earlier, it can be full or it can be a simple query type. Full means it supports all the wildcards and regular expressions, as we have seen. Now behind the scenes, stage one, it breaks your particular search query, search text, into a Boolean query parsing tree, where it says that it should have a spacious, air condition is hyphenated, that's why it contains your complete word, right? And it's also a wildcard query, so anything, you know, air conditioner may be a field in a text in the document, which will be part of the result, and it must contain ocean view as a phrase query, right? So it does that query parsing behind the scenes. And stage two is the lexical analysis, where your analyzer runs and it breaks down your individual term queries, prefix query, phrase queries into your
root form, like you apply all the filters and analyzers on top of it, and you can say you can see that, you know, it has the term query spacious, prefix query, air condition, phrase query, and ocean view, and it also lowercased because this is where a standard analyzer which we have used, so it lowercased all your term queries for a better case insensitive kind of a search results. Stage 3 is the document retrieval, and stage 4 is the scoring mechanisms. Now in the results, we have seen that every result or every data JSON body had a search score associated with it. Now that search score indicates that your particular search query, how important it is, or you know, what is the rank of that particular query. So it uses a term frequency, inverse document frequency kind of an algorithm. I'll not go much into details of it, since this is very particular to Elasticsearch engine, how it behaves on top of it, but it uses the same mechanism in order to calculate that particular score. We'll move into more interesting stuff. So these are the basics, what I have covered of Azure Search, right? But it's missing most of the parts. So we had a structured data set as an input, a database basically as an input, and it inferred it from that all the fields associated with that particular search index. Now what if I have all the documents, let's say JPG documents, XLS, all kinds of stuff, right? All kinds of document formats associated with it, and I want to search in those documents, in those images. The images may have text in it. I want search capabilities on top of it. Now this is where AI capabilities or the Azure AI comes into picture, where you can build your cognitive search pipeline into Azure Search, and you know, you can basically enhance your search experience. So I'll just quickly go through the portal and show you how it works. So if I use my this is the search service which I had used, if you remember, and I said import data, right? I can use it's a sample data, any data I want, and I want to add a cognitive search on top of it. Now let's say when I go here, I attach cognitive search. So this cognitive search is already created. Now you want, so how do you create it is, let me show you from the start. So you have cognitive services, right? You create a cognitive service. I've already created one, so I won't create it again. So you can just enter the name of the cognitive services and all the cognitive capabilities of Azure, text recognition, you know, key phrases, whatever we have discussed at the start will be available to you in the Azure Search pipeline. Now we'll just add that cognitive capability in your Azure Search. So let me go to my Azure Search. So. So resource key, I'll put it in the same resource group, best US, and keep this pricing tier as standard. We might be running out of time here, but if you have any questions, just feel free to, you know, kind of ask it over chat and we can go through it. We might not get separate time for Q&As. So as it gets deployed, I can answer some of those if I can. All right. So my search service is up. I import data. So first of all, I need a storage account, right? So I need a storage account where all my data is stored. So I already have one. So this is my storage account, and in the blobs, in the samples, right, I have all these blobs. Now, what are these files? So as you can see, it has all the TXT, JPEG, PDF, DocX, PDF files, everything, every possible type of a file, which has been present in this particular unstructured format in this container, and we'll do a search on top of it. Let me just also open the files so that we see that it's working fine. So in the existing data storage, I select Azure Blob Storage, right? I give it a name, right? So let's say live webinar is my name. Data to extract. Now this is the content and the metadata both. So every blob has a content, which is the actual data present in the blob, and the metadata associated. So I need to extract both of it. Parsing mode is default, or you can have text, JSON, JSON array, or delimited text. So if you have a CSV file in your blob, if you choose delimited text, then Azure Search will smartly read that CSV file, and it will segregate those particular data into columns in your, as fields in your indexes. If you have a JSON documents, it will read those JSON documents. It will read that, it will understand that particular JSON structure, and it will, you know, kind of give out the fields or, you know, intelligently find out what fields you need in the index. I'll keep it as default for now, choose an existing connection. So I'll choose an existing storage, which has all type of files, right? And I say next. Add cognitive search. Now remember, these are the files which has the structured as well as unstructured data. Now some are JSON files, some are images. Let me share my screen here. It shows you. So you see the portal and you see the sample file. So if you see, you have a PNG file of Scott Guthrie, right, with his famous red t-shirt. You have Satya Nadella speaking at a conference. Again, these kind of images. Now what we'll see, the actual, you know, kind of magic happening where the text and everything gets extracted out of those images. So this is the cognitive search which I have already created.
So as I have shown before, you can create your own cognitive search, or you can have a free, but it doesn't work with, you know, a lot of kind of a data. So if you have a text which has lots of data in it, it will trim your particular or truncate your particular search on top of that. So it has very limited functionality available for in a free tier, but I have chosen a standard kind of a cognitive resource here, right? I can add enrichments. Now, enrichments are nothing but, as I mentioned before, as you move through different pipelines of your Azure search, you add different kind of skills to it. Now, one is the OCR field. OCR is nothing but your optical character recognition, where what Azure search will do is it will crawl your storage account. It will read that particular, okay, it's an image. It will run through an OCR, Microsoft OCR engine. It will extract all the text from it and it will add it into the merged content field. So that is a OCR skill, or the AI OCR skill, which Microsoft has. Similar to it, it has different cognitive skills which you can enable. I want all the people names, you know, there are famous people like Satya Nadella was there, Scott Guthrie was there. So I need the people names also in my extracted data, organization names, the locations, key phrases, also detect the language of the text which has been used, right? Image cognitive skills, generate tags from the images, captions, as well as famous celebrities from the images. So these kind of skills, you can add it to your pipeline and you can, you know, enhance your particular pipeline as you move forward, put more and more. So these are just the out of the box pipeline, but you can add your own custom kind of skills and push it in the index schema so that you get much more enriched documents. Now, these are nothing. This is nothing but enriching your index with all these skills out of the box. Now, save enrichments to knowledge store. I won't go much deep into it. This is in preview. This is fairly recent. So as I said before, whatever data which has been extracted out of this can be saved in storage accounts with the tables and the blobs. Right, so I have enriched this particular pipeline and I have extracted all the, I mean, I have selected all the fields. In the next in the next screen, you saw that, you know, you have a index name. I see that as maybe one metadata storage path, suggester name. You can type in any suggester name. Search mode, currently it's one. And you can see that the field names which has been you know, shown here is what Microsoft Azure have crawled through the documents and found that, okay, these are the field, probable field names which is relevant to my particular search index. So you have celebrities, text, layout text, key phrases, etc. All have been kind of, you know, extracted and for use, the design, the schema of this particular index has already been created for you. You can add or modify as per your requirements. Analyzers. So I'll keep it standard Lucene for all of them. Right, you can change anything you want. You just create an index here. So as you can see that, you know, it's very easy to build your complete pipeline, complete intelligent search pipeline, adding cognitive capabilities to it on click of a button. You don't need to do anything. So I'll just name it as an indexer, schedule, for now it's once. Base64 encoded, we have already talked what it is, right? Data to extract content and metadata, default and submit. Now, once I click submit, it is going behind the scenes. Okay, so I've got an error. Suggestors must have at least one source fields. Okay, so looks like I haven't selected a suggestor. So Azure Blob Storage. Okay, so it is probably one of the enhancement or drawback, which it doesn't save my previous history. Quickly move through these fields. Cognitive search, index schema detected. Select the cognitive service, add enrichments. So my skill set, let's do this one for three because I already had some of it. So merge content, I'll add all the cognitive skills here, customized target index. So in the suggestor, maybe I keep it as blank now. I don't need a suggestor for now. Let's say create an indexer. Okay, now it is, what it is doing is my indexer is running, it's in progress, it's crawling through my data source, you know, OCRing the documents and enriching my my index with all the cognitive skills which I had kind of selected during creation of index. So let's give this some time. If you have any questions, please feel free to ask. Unable to see your screen. Okay. Can you see my screen now? Azure portal? Okay. Sorry about that, but we just created a service with all the cognitive services selected, right? And it's in progress. Let's give it some time. It will take some time to enrich my pipeline. Any questions on chat in the meantime? All right, so it's completed. It's showing me warning. So 18 documents have been succeeded. I had around 18 documents. So you can see that 18 out of 18 had been processed. There are some warnings. Let's see what those warnings are. So you can click on it. You can go through it. And in the warnings, you can say that cannot iterate over non-array. So there will be some cases where the text is huge or some of the cognitive services weren't able to process that successfully, because those are still in preview mode. So those kind of stuff will be there, but more or less, you know, our input data has been processed and we are ready to use queries on those images. Now let me just duplicate my screen so that people. Okay, so these were my files, okay, and I also had this image which shows Canadian Prime Minister Justin Trudeau with Shah Rukh Khan and on one of the events. So let's try to search this and see if we get it right. Right, so Postman tool, right, cognitive search example. So Justin Trudeau. If I say send, you can see that the result of that particular image coming up in my result set, right? And it has detected the image caption. It's a person posing for a photo, standing in a group, dress. There are certain image tags as well, you know, smile, pose, man. And it also detected the celebrities, Shah Rukh Khan and Justin Trudeau, from the image itself. So that's how powerful the cognitive search capabilities gives us. So this is just tip of the iceberg, right? So this is just an image processing, but you can have all sorts of AI capabilities, text phrases, sentiment skills, organizations also has been detected. So all those skills has been enabled for you out of the box on in Azure, at cloud scale. So that is the power of cognitive search, which you get via Azure search. Right. So any questions before I move forward? We are almost past the time. I had some other things to discuss, but looks like we may not get there. So Manish, how much time do we have? 5 minutes, 10 minutes? You're almost past it, right? Hello. So we have covered most of it, the business end-to-end solutions. So as you can see, with this particular background, you can build any kind of web apps. You can build bots, Microsoft bot framework on top of it, which can, behind the scenes query your Azure search, bring up the results. You can use Power BI as your visualization tool. All sorts of stuff you can do once you have Azure search with cognitive capabilities enabled on top of it, so that it's a much smarter experience, much seamless experience for your user base if you have unstructured data, any kind of data in your store, right? So that's a video. So a use case, what we... All right, so I see some questions. You can extend by 5 to 2 times. Could you give an overview from the start to end about the topic? Yes, Srina, I can give that. Or maybe I can share the deck as well. So if you have any specific questions, probably if we can address, or I can give you an overview once we close this particular call. I didn't have much time, but you know, we have covered most of the basic stuff. You can extend it. Now, this is one of the Azure function which I had, you know, which is which basically translates your particular text to a different language, right? So this wasn't present in your cognitive search pipeline. So this is one of the custom skill which you can add later in your pipeline. So you can have an Azure function written which takes your input, right? I'll just show you the Postman example here. Right, so this is my Azure function. So you just pass in the text, and in the query string you can say whatever language you want to process it, right? I'll just run it. Behind the scenes, it uses the API cognitive Microsoft translator. And my services are up. I can send a request, and this particular text I want it to be converted to Hindi, which is the, you know, HI is the code of the language, and it gets converted. Now this capability can be added in my Azure search by default so that it is available for all the documents. And how to do that is you can update your cognitive search index using REST APIs. Now this, or the skill set, I'm sorry. So this is a skill, right? So the entity recognition skill, key phrase extraction, OCR skill, and this is a custom skill, custom web API skill, where you can add your you can, you know, mention the URI or the resource, the URL of the resource where you can call. You can give an output, which is /document/content, which is the extracted content, and the output is the translated text, so that in the output, when you search, or you can, let's say a simple search or index. So basically the idea is when you search, you get that as a property. So you see translated text. So currently it's null. Maybe something, you know, the text was too long or something like that. But the idea is you get your custom skill hooked up into the Azure search, into the pipeline using the APIs, post API, REST APIs. And then in the results, you can get that particular data or that particular skill running on your data store. So we are at almost at the closure of it. I wanted to cover a business scenario which we had implemented using Azure Search. Actually, our CTO Monish Darda have you know, had a presentation last year in Microsoft Ignite, and I'll just paste in the link. Maybe somewhere here open on how iCertis is using or leveraging the power of Azure Search. And how it's been useful for us in an enterprise kind of an application. Right, so I'll not play this right now, but you can go through this around 28th minute. You can see how we are using this in our applications, in our particular product, how we are leveraging the Azure Search and using it to enhance or, you know, the user experience and everything. All right, so I'm done from my end. If you have any questions,